Father, thank you for your word. We hear it, we receive it, that we may be a doer of it. You increase, we decrease. Father, we give you praise, honor, and glory in Jesus' name. Amen. Pretty soon we're going to celebrate Pentecost. I think it's May 15, the precious outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And as I've been going through this word, I've been speaking about the anointing. And in the word that he gave us for this year, he said, I will enable you to reach forth for all I have already provided to secure your victory. I have released every spiritual blessing upon you. And I love that because he's saying, I have done something. I know you're waiting for something, but I have done some things. And what I have done is above anything else that I can do. I have already released, that he says in this specific word, every spiritual blessing upon you. Every spiritual blessing. And then he says, until now you've been held back by trials and oppression. And then he says, this is the season of your release. So first he says, I have released some things. And then he says, this is the season of your release. Oh, hallelujah. I love the way that God leads us to walk into things that he has gone ahead of us to prepare the way. I love the way he tells us that we are his workmanship, prepared beforehand for good works. Because that means that everywhere that I walk, I know he already has prepared the way for me. I know that everywhere that I walk, even if there's things that appear to be crooked, they're not even as crooked as they would have been if my God would not have been able to go ahead before me. And every crooked things that he has left it to take me to a place that now he can release things in and through you for some other crooked things. That Father, in his training up like you are, he said, okay, there's some things I'm going to do, but there's some things that I'm going to enable you to do so that you can know that you are being transformed into the image of Christ from glory to glory. I'm telling you that. I gave you every spiritual blessing according to that, but now I need you to know that. And I need the whole world to know that I am not one who has a body that's decapitated. You know, in French, they have the guillotine. Schlag. They cut. That's the wrong schlag. But they cut your head off. I remember being a little girl and my father came to take me, you know, for visits, and he was always drunk, of course. So you're in those small roads in France, and then he stops somewhere, and he says, come, look. So I'm going, look. And he took to get me to visit this place where they used to guillotine people, schlag people. So there he's drunk. There is the wood with dried up blood from 15 whenever, right? And I'm thinking, how fun. Because they used to cut people's head off. And in the spirit, Jesus as the head has been cut off for too long. So the Lord, now he doesn't want things to be disconnected anymore. He's moving in such a way that he wants the whole world to see his body. That there was a time in the book of Acts, because he was preparing the way and everything he was doing, that people were able to see him. And the disciples, the 12 and the 70. But now we after Pentecost. So now he desires the whole world to see his body through you. Amen? So I want to look at a passage in 2 Corinthians. Oh, my God, can we handle another schlag night? Last week we took care of some trucks. How many got freedom from some trucks? How many went home looking for the truck? Oh, nobody's praised the Lord. Hallelujah. There's nothing that being free from a truck and going home looking for it. But sometimes the truck has been on you for so long that you don't know how to act without it. Amen. And some of the trucks that he removed are so strong, that there's a transition that now you're in, learning to walk free, learning to walk released from some things. Amen? So look at 2 Corinthians chapter 12. I want to read this familiar passage. And it says in verse 7 of chapter 12, "And lest I should be exalted above measure by the abundance of the revelations, a thorn in the flesh was given to me, a messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I be exalted above measure." So he's saying he was receiving so much revelation, so many visions. He was growing so much in the Lord that the enemy, Satan, just sent forth a battle, a war against him, and sent forth that thorn in the flesh that was buffeting him. And that word buffet is literally bang, 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 bang. It's not like one hit. It's like bang, 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 bang. The word buffet is constant, it's strong, it's without ceasing. It's an incredible war that you find yourself in when you finally understand that God has released spiritual blessings upon you, and you start allowing him to release some things in and through you in your life. There's a buffeting, there's a thorn in the flesh. There's some things that happen with the battle between the flesh and the spirit. And here, it's so that he's not exalted above measure. Because if Satan can use pride in your life, he will try. But God resists the proud. But he gives grace to the humble. And this is what he's showing here. He says, "Concerning this thing, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. And he said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, I will rather boast in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure. I jump up and down. I'm so happy in my infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecution, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong." And he's saying this beautiful thing is that he went and he prayed 3 times, "Remove this thorn in the flesh. Remove it." And the answer of God was, "My grace is sufficient for you." And sometimes you hear that thought that means, you know, que sera, sera, whatever will be,
will be.
You talk like, you know, well, you got grace. That's all you need. And it sounds like you stuck with your stuff. You stuck with all your mess. There's no hope. His grace is sufficient. You don't need anything else. Who do you think you are? You got God's grace, but that's not what he says. That's not what Father says. Grace is not something that's given unto us that's little. No, no, grace is divine ability. Grace is divine ability. When I think of the anointing, when you see here that he's talking, well, whatever happened upon me, I rejoice, I jump up and down, that the power of the anointed one may rest upon me. In other words, whatever is happening in the flesh doesn't matter, because God's anointing come to set me free from it. It doesn't matter what it is. It doesn't matter if it's infirmities, distresses, whatever it comes. It's like the testimony Minister Brenda had. It was a beautiful testimony. She had peace for her hair, but hey, she also had peace when her medicine was gone. It didn't matter what came at her. This is the grace that God, he says, you don't have to ask me, I've already have released upon you. I'm teaching you, my son. I'm teaching you, my daughter. I'm teaching you what you got. There's some things you will come to me to pray for, your personal relationship, for your personal prayer, intimate prayer, one-on-one prayer. We talk to him. We communicate with him. But when you're messing with the enemy and you walk through things in your life, Father is like, I've given you the stuff. You are anointed. So when the thorn of the flesh comes and the enemy comes to buffet you, jump up and down and don't pay attention to that, but release the grace, release what I have released upon you, release the divine ability, release the abundant grace that I have given you. You have the power of the anointed one. You are anointed. So come forth against what comes upon you, because I already have given you the goods. I have released upon you. So yes, you can come to me all you want, ask me to remove the thorn. If I do it, you're not going to learn. If I do it, you're not going to know what you're made of. I need you to know what you're made of. I need you to know, because that's how people around you will know who you belong to. There's sometimes in our lives, the thorn in the flesh, whatever that might be. I went through some things even when I started a ministering on the radio, where I had sores all in my mouth. And I talk about that in Counting the Cost, I think. But it's my first time on the radio. Oh, God. And I can barely open my mouth. I had never had those things before. But I heard my grace. Oh. When you know that his grace is sufficient for you. I remember one day my voice was totally gone, and it was 5 minutes before 7, and I'm preparing, and in the office, Reverend Kay said, you want me to call somebody to go ahead and preach for you? And I said, his grace. His grace. Grace is not something we take for granted. People come against the people that preach grace like they're doing something that's not good for the people. What do you mean? What do you mean it's not good? It's the key to be able to walk in the things of God. Grace means that there's some things that I cannot do on my own, but he anointed me to do it. And I step into it. I step into it. I step into it. And the moment that I step into it, and that I stand up here, and many witnesses are here, I open my mouth, and it works. It works. When I was on the radio, I opened my mouth. By the time I got in my car, it was gone, because I came against the enemy that was coming to buffet me, to stop me from doing what God was calling me to do. But if God calls me to do anything, if He calls you to do anything, He will anoint you to do it. And there's a connection between grace and anointing. People think that they're going to walk in greater anointing based on them being so perfect and all that, and making other people feel so small. Are you kidding? It's by grace that we stand. But you have to know that grace doesn't mean that you're all left by yourself. No, you have His grace. No. Father, thank you for your divine ability. For the grace that you give me to stand where I should fall. For the grace that you give me to speak when I shouldn't be able to. For the grace that you give me to believe for a mate when in the natural I shouldn't get one. For the grace you give me to make ends do when my bills are paid, when 2 days ago I didn't know they were going to get paid. That's grace, that's divine ability to be able to get up and believe, to be able to trust on God. That's grace, grace. Work. My grace is sufficient for thee, not because it's little and that's all you're getting, but because that's all you need. Yeah. Hallelujah. It's because that's all you need. You only need His anointing, His divine ability that comes when you don't deserve it, and then you walk in it, and then He does more. And He does more, and He does more, and it gets you to the point that you just get on your knees. Grace is not for us to continue to sin. Grace helps us not sin. Grace is not something that we just say before dinner. Everybody say grace. No, not you. Paul got a hold of this thing that you can see to the point that when they got out of the tempest, the shipwreck that they all went through, and they get on the island, and you remember they build a fire, and you know the story in the midst of the fire, when Paul has his hands, he's building the fire. See, when you're building something to help others, when you do anything for God, you have to expect, don't be surprised, do not be concerned, if suddenly you're doing something for God, and Here comes the viper in the midst of the wood that he's putting together. Don't be concerned when you do something and something happened to battle you. The enemy, every time the enemy battles me and buffet me, I take it as a great confirmation. Because I used to be in a place in my life that he wasn't coming against me. I was walking along his side. Take that drug, drink this, do that. Yes. Didn't even have to pray about it. I didn't know how. It's a confirmation, but it's not a confirmation that you're going to go through the suffering, that you're going to go through the thing that come onto you. No, it's a confirmation. Oh, it's showtime. you buffet me and you come against me. Now watch the power of Christ rest upon me. Watch the power of God come upon me greater, that instead of stopping me, now we're going to be stronger, greater. Instead of being stopped, now God, because I know many of you have been going through such a buffeting time. But if I look at your life, I see you starting to just fight back like Paul with the snake in the middle of the wood. And everybody is around him. You know the story. All talking about him. Well, what did he do last night for the enemy to mess with him like that? They didn't say that, I'm paraphrasing, but they're all expecting him to die. Because when you go through things, people will talk about you, and they will think that it's because you've done something. You're such a bad person. So, I mean, it's an incredible story, because he's standing there with a snake in his hand, and people around him, he's building the fire for them, and instead of helping him, I mean, I pray if I had a snake right now along my leg, that all of you would run and put it off me, right? You would hurry up, right? You would fight for one another. But anyway, when you go through things in your life, there's always some people around you that are just expecting you to fall. They don't want anything good for you. They're just expecting you to, you know, especially if you shared any kind of dream or vision you had with them. They just, every time they see you, they're just expecting you to go down. So that's what they're doing. They're around him expecting. But see, he's at a place because he learned that his grace is sufficient. And you know that this grace is sufficient when you truly believe that God is all sufficient. He's really all you need. Not all you need to remain who you are in the flesh, but he's all you need to become who he says you are, to become who he already has released you to be. He wants you to be released in this season. This is the season of your release. So Paul doesn't pay attention to them, because when you're ready to walk in the anointing, you cannot look to the right. You cannot look to the left. You can't pay attention to what other people are saying. You're not here to please them. They're not the one that put you out of situation where you went in. They're not the one who saved you, who just brought you out from the bottom of the pit to take you to the top of your situation. They were not there when nobody else was there. It's never a time to just let other people around in your life just hinder you. If he would have looked at them, he would have been hindered. No, but he knew the snake, the thorn, everything that comes at you. He knew, he got a hold of this thing. That's why he said in 2 Corinthians right there, I take pleasure. I don't think Paul was like, I don't think he was freaking out like that, you know? I don't think so. After everything that he went through, he just shook it off. The scripture says he shook it off. Like, he didn't even give it a time of the day, I'm not going to think about like that. I'm not going to listen to that lie. I'm not going to go there. I'm not going to receive that pain. I'm going to press forth. And right after he did that, there was a mighty move of the Spirit. Where Publius got healed and everything happened. Because when you, and I'm telling you, because I believe God is beginning to do these kind of things in and through you, like never before. When it says, I take pleasure, the Greek literally means I jump up and down. So it's not just, you know, a little bit happy, but I don't know if that ever happened to you, to get a disconnecting notice and to go, hey, hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Woo-hoo! The power of Christ is about to rest upon me. The slacking anointing is upon me. I can't pay my bills. I can't pay my rent. Hallelujah. Why? How could he do that? He could do that because he knew that the power of Christ was going to pull him out of whatever was coming at him. How many of you tonight believe that? How come there's the music already? Oh. What is it tonight that we need to shake off? What is it tonight that we just need to... I don't know if that's a prophetic act, but you know, and do it with an attitude, you know? I call it the matrix. I love when I tell you about the matrix at the end of the movie. It was cool. At the beginning, he didn't know who he was. He didn't know the strength that he had. He didn't know his identity. See, we've been like this for too many years now. It's time for a shift. We can't be acting in front of the enemy like we scared, we defeated. Come on, Satan, make my day. All I have is grace. No, religion really has messed up people. They don't believe. They go through stuff just believing that they actually believe it's God doing that stuff to them. It's messed up. It's time for a shift. It's the year of release. We need to be released for that. When things come, you have to know the power of Christ that rests upon you and press through. And the moment that you press through, you shake off what came upon you. The moment that you press through what was trying to come upon you, fasten against you, the moment that you go forth because you believe is in divine ability, shoo. So at the end of the movie, the guy in Matrix, standing like this, bullets are coming, whatever, and he's just like, cool, calm, and collected. He knows who he is. Amen? He's not, the enemy is going to get me. No, the enemy was defeated on the cross. He's just, he has some power, but he doesn't have any authority. So he lies to the people. We have the authority and the power. So when I speak, when I spoke, even though I had sores in my mouth, when I spoke, even though I couldn't speak, I was shaking him off. I was standing calm, cool, and collected. I didn't say, what am I going to do? Because if God was calling me, then he had to do it. I remember when I started the radio program and I started looking at the bills, back then was $400. For me as a single parent, it was like $4 million. No money to pay $400. Now remember one day I looked at it. He said, never look at it. I said, what do you mean? Not look at it. It's a bill, Lord. What do you want me to do? He said, no. Never forget. When I decide, I provide. It's my will. It's my bill. I will anoint you, it will be paid for. He said, never look at the number of zeros that's after a number. Amen? So I shook up the enemy. No, I'm not going to look at the bill. My father got this. No, I'm not going to pay attention to what's going on in my body. I'm going to do what it tells me to do. And I've learned over the years, I'm not just a slacker, I'm a shaker. I slack. and I shake. I shake the enemy off and I slap people in the name of Jesus. And sometimes I do both at the same time. Like tonight, I want to shake and I want to slack. And then I might slack again and shake some more. I want to shake off the enemy. I want you to leave this church tonight, mighty shakers for the kingdom. I want you to leave tonight empowered to shake off the enemy when he comes upon you with lies, with nonsense. What if this? What if that? Shake him off. Shake him off. Shake him off. Hallelujah. Step forth and become a mighty, mighty anointed slacker, shaker. Hallelujah. God is raising you up to shake the world with the kingdom, to shake the enemy of everything that comes upon you. You don't have to be fearful. You don't have to be depressed. You don't have to be worried. Your God is on your side. And if God is for you, who can be against you? God who begun a good work, he will perfect it. He will never let you down. He is with you. He's holding on to you. He will never shake you up. God is on your side. God is on your side. Hallelujah. His grace is sufficient. Stand to your feet and declare it out loud. His grace is sufficient for me. Hallelujah. Satan, I shake you off my life. My family, I shake off the lies. I shake off the pain. I shake off the worries. I shake you off. And I rejoice. Because the power of Christ rests upon me. I'm anointed. I'm a believer. I'm a slacker. And tonight, I will shake. I will slack. And I am unstoppable. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory.